On the line right now is Kara Thomas from Spectrum News. Kara was there start to finish. She's been certainly delivering us the news as we've asked throughout the entire trial. And Kara, good morning. Thanks for coming on. Your thoughts on the verdict that came down late yesterday?
Well, it was definitely shocking. So, yeah. I mean, I don't think the timing of it was shocking. I mean, this was only 2 hours after the jury had come out with a note to the judge saying they were deadlocked.
Yeah, that's so
and
bizarre.
You know, that they needed a minute to take, they all just needed a minute to go to lunch, you know, or needed a moment.
Yeah.
Then they come back from lunch, send a note saying they're deadlocked, and then the judge sends them back with an Allen charge. They come back 2 hours later, and they've got a verdict.
I mean,
all of us, none of us saw it coming at all.
Yeah, how do you in 2 hours? That's the thing that is odd to me. How do you in 2 hours, how do you just change your mind and say, you know what, yep, I'm in, guilty after all? It's odd.
Yeah, I mean, none of us were in the room. You know, none of us were in that deliberations room. None of us knew what the conversations that were going on, but it definitely took us by surprise.
So what was it like in the courtroom? There are reports that that the mother of Caitlin Connolly was understandably upset and almost uncontrollably upset.
Mm-hmm. It was heartbreaking.
Yeah.
You know, you're sitting there, and Caitlin, I think, was trying to be strong or was shocked or something, because she wasn't showing much emotion at all. Until it was when the juror, the foreman, said guilty, you hear the mother kind of just make a noise that was just like pain, you know, and then she just hit her face in her husband's chest and just sobbed uncontrollably. It was sobs and screams. It was just heartbreaking. And, you know, eventually the judge did ask her to leave. And, you know, as she was walking out the door, she just cried out, but she's innocent. I mean, it was very sad. And, you know, Caitlin, but Caitlin looked back, you know, on several occasions, just looked at her family and just said, I'm okay. I'm okay. Are you okay? I'm okay. You know, and it was very emotional in that courtroom. And obviously the Yoder family was obviously very emotional as well. They were not as outwardly emotional as the Conleys, but obviously very emotional, hugging each other. They went into the hallway just holding each other. You know, finally a sense of relief in this case, a sense of closure.
And you wonder how much closure one would expect. I would imagine that Caitlin Connolly will appeal the decision, which starts start this all over again.
Yep, I spoke with Frank Policelli. I know you're going to speak with him later, but I spoke with him yesterday. He has full intentions of appealing. Doesn't feel like the verdict was fair at all. And you'll hear more from him, obviously. But he plans on taking this, and hopefully he feels very strongly that the verdict will be overturned by an appellate judge. But we'll just have to see.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Kara, I think we all assume this, but I guess this started out as a whodunit. Does the family think that she's responsible for killing their mother, their wife? Have you had a chance to talk to
the Yoder family?
I'm sorry, yes, the Yoder family. Do they think that she was the one who did this?
I'm certain. I haven't spoken to them personally. They have not wanted to speak to the media. They're a very private family. But from things that they'd said on the stand, things that Bill Yoder had said when he was on the stand, it was obvious that their opinions of her had completely changed since how they felt about her back in 2015.
Yeah, okay,
You know, as almost part of their family, she was included in a lot of different things, and they did not feel the same way. And while they didn't directly say, you know, they believe she's the one who did it's pretty obvious that they feel that way about her.
I'm not even going to try to trick you into telling us how you really think, because you won't fall for it. But I would ask you this, based on people, you know, obviously the reporters in the room, those that are independent, not connected to either side. Was anybody saying anything? Was anybody saying, boy, I really thought she was not guilty, or I thought she was guilty of the murder charge? What were you hearing from other reporters and other people who were independent?
Yeah, you know, the one thing that, and I think Frank will talk to you about this when he comes on, but the matter of intent here,
yeah.
I think what was surprising to people was that if they weren't able to find intent, that she poisoned Mary with the intent to kill her,
right.
Then how could they find that she poisoned her with the intent to seriously harm her, especially after, I know, the prosecution's biggest change in evidence, which I guess I didn't realize until yesterday, the backup to Conley's iPhone, that was completely new evidence in this trial, which I knew, I just figured they just weren't presenting it for some odd reason.
Yeah.
They didn't find that backup until a few months ago, so after the first trial. And on that backup, that's where they found that Conley, they believe Conley was searching these, researching about toxins and poisons, and found articles that were saying, why is thallium the poison for the best choice for poisoners and terrorists, and
right.
and the world's most toxic substances or toxic chemicals. And those were the types of articles that were screenshotted and found on the backup of Conley's phone. And so I think that was a really big deal for this jury. But at the same time, it's kind of confusing of, wouldn't those types of articles make you think, lean you more towards intent to kill versus intent to harm?
Right, right. So if you can't have, I spoke with Frank last night, and that's exactly, livid is the word I would use to mm-hmm. describe him on that, and disappointed in the jury, and how quickly they were able to change from were a hung jury to guilty, but this all fits though in his defense, saying that wasn't her searching that on her computer or on her phone. He had mm-hmm. Adam Yoder had access. And all of that fits. There is still no proof that it was her that was on the phone and on the computer when someone else could have had access.
Well, no direct proof.
Right.
You're right. There's no direct proof that, but from my understanding, they did, Mr. Martino from the Utica College Cyber Forensics Lab, he came back on the stand and he had pulled up, and I could be wrong on the dates, but I know that there were certain dates that Mr. Policelli asked him about, saying, well, was there any other usage on that phone when that was happening? And I'm pretty sure, I'm like 90% sure, that those dates and times that he suggested were when she was doing those searches for articles. And around that same time, she was also getting text messages back and forth. If I'm incorrect, I mean, Mr. Policelli can definitely correct me in those moments when he comes back on. But I know that that's what the prosecution was trying to prove, was that there's no way that someone else had her phone, because she was doing other things on her phone around that same time,
right, right.
texting her sister, texting, you know, other people.
Yeah.
So I know that was the prosecution's argument anyway.
It's funny because you hear all of these different theories. People have theories of, I can't believe they're not going down this road. I heard a theory yesterday of someone saying, well, actually, to be honest with you, I think that she never intended to kill Mary Yoder, but maybe she intended to kill the boyfriend, and Mary Yoder just drank the drink. I mean, everybody's conspiracy theories coming out, and who knows, in an appeal, it's possible we could hear one of those.
Yeah, potentially. I mean, we went from the first trial where the defense was trying to point blame at the husband,
right.
at William Yoder. We've got the second trial where they're attempting to point blame at the son, at Adam Yoder. It may be a completely different...
Yeah.
Completely different theory coming up, but you're right. There is a lot of, there were just so many questions and so many things that just didn't make sense in this trial. You know, the prosecution says they continued to follow the evidence, and this is where it led them. It led them to Caitlin Conley, and that's what they stuck with. And the defense, you know, continues to bring up that things just don't make sense,
yeah.
and it doesn't make sense for Caitlin to have committed this crime. So it'll definitely be interesting to see what an appellate court judge thinks of this case.
All I can say is we appreciate, Kara, your time that you've given us on this, and gave us some insight into the courtroom. Sounds like it just was an emotional roller coaster that ended with a big surprise yesterday.
Most definitely, and no problem. I appreciate you having me on.
All right. Yes, Kara, thank you so much.
Kara Thomas, Spectrum News. Thanks so much. Enjoy your day. Thank you.